So Neil and I are going to team teach this. We've never done this before.
In fact...
So if it goes badly, it's Neil's fault?
And if it goes well, it's his doing. You know, I guess that's... Is that how it goes?
That's something like that.
Yeah. That's loving this already. You know, it's a win-win.
What I want to do is just introduce the topic by highlighting the importance of leadership to you. And then I'm going to kick to Neil. And we're going to get some real awesome definitions. Thanks, Andrew. We had a wonderful message on this topic for our church service. It really has opened this up.
Alistair, there's more there if people want more, and there's more in the other box there. And it's not one for, you know, one for family. You know, we're just trying to save trees.
Why don't we have a prayer? And then I just want to highlight a few things to you why this topic, of all topics, is so important. Let's just bow our heads together. Father, we just thank you that we can learn from you. Your son Jesus Christ, when he walked on the earth, was the most incredible of leaders. And as we heard this morning, he turned leadership on its head. Hmm. How's it different from secular leadership, Lord? And what all that means is what we're going to do today. But Father, we want your spirit because we need your spirit. Please be in the meeting. Help us as we discuss and reflect on this, we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
So I just want to start by highlighting some issues with you from Scripture that tell us why leadership is important. Can you think of any books in the Bible where it highlights the importance of leadership? Now, you're talking, I'm not talking. Nehemiah is a wonderful leadership book. Exodus, Numbers 6, Moses was the most humblest man. Esther, Acts, Matthew, Timothy, writing to a young leader. Ezra and Nehemiah.
1st, 2nd Kings, 1st, 2nd Chronicles.
1st and 2nd Samuel.
1st, 2nd Samuel. In fact, show me a book in the Bible that really doesn't have some leadership going on.
It is... You can look at the Bible with many different glasses on and you say, I'm going to look and find Jesus throughout the whole Bible. And there he is the whole way along. Or I can look and I can say, what were all the messages of repentance? And I'll find all these messages of repentance. If you put your glasses on with leadership written on them, you'll discover that this is the issue that determines the fate of God's people again and again and again and again.
And yet, it's only mentioned 6 times in the Bible.
And we'll don't jump ahead.
Oh, sorry.
Don't jump ahead. He's bad like that.
Down, boy.
Moses, my servant, he said. He didn't say Moses, my leader. But if you look at, if we've got a good king in Israel, what does Israel do?
Prospers.
They prosper. They obey God. They draw close to him and keep his covenant. But if you get a bad leader, what does everyone else do? They follow the leader. It sounds like a nursery rhyme that everyone follows the leader. But in fact, I love Numbers 11 as one of the great case studies. Numbers chapter 11 on leadership in the scripture. Because it contrasts two different guys and two different styles of leadership. It shows Moses, he says to God, they're whinging about their lunch. The lunch didn't have garlic and cucumbers and leeks. It was manna. Moses says, I've had enough of this. Why have you put this burden on me? He's burdened down with leadership. God says, don't worry, I've heard you. Go and choose 70 others. And we have a little Acts chapter 2 in the Old Testament in Numbers 11 where God pours his spirit out and the 70 elders, the Bible says they all prophesied, but there were two people in the audience that day. The Bible calls them Eldad and Medad. They were not with the other 70, but God placed his spirit on them anyway. Moses had someone he was training to be the new leader. Do you remember who that was? Joshua.
And? He had another one, Caleb.
Joshua, there's always got to be a backup.
Yeah, yeah.
There's always a backup.
No, well, it's just like one of our plans is to have three that you replace yourself
That's
with.
Right.
And Moses had that.
He's got Joshua sees someone up the back gifted in leadership by the Holy Spirit, and Joshua says to Moses, stop him, stop them. They're not part of what should be happening. When Joshua died, who replaced him? No one. You don't have an answer because there's not an answer. When Joshua dies, he never developed a new leader. That was his responsibility. It is always the church's responsibility to grow leaders. It is not. God will give the Spirit to them, but the church has to grow them. Joshua never grew anyone. When Moses dies, things go to another gear. It goes even better than before, and they conquer the land because he's trained up the guy to do it. But his guy never trained anyone. And what happens after Joshua? We get what's called the Book of Judges.
Oh, and it's not good.
Utter chaos. And if you think that's an accident, when Jesus dies and goes back to heaven, who replaces him? The disciples. We know that Paul spent some time developing Timothy. But I want to put it to you that dark ages happened because the church stopped discipling and stopped growing new leaders. And the world went into a terrible place. Leadership is the issue for any organization, but it is absolutely the issue for God's church. Neil, talk to us about what leadership is.
Thanks, Justin. Just building on what Ty said this morning, okay, just thinking around leadership. There are many things, and we're going to unpack some of those key words in a moment. But one of the very first things I just want you to think about is this. What's the difference between management and leadership? So if we just think about management for a minute, management is like if I'm in a forest, this is what Stephen Covey says, if I'm in a forest and I'm a manager, my job is to manage the chopping down of the trees as fast and as efficiently as I can. I'm managing the wood cutting. If I'm a leader, however, I'm in the forest and I climb to the tallest tree in the forest and I'm looking around the forest and I actually say to the team down there being led by a very good manager, oh, by the way, we're in the wrong spot. We should be over there. So just help me, what's the difference between then management and leadership in that illustration? This is where you've got to do some thinking. Vision. Yeah, being able to see like that. What else is there? Perspective. So what's the perspective of a leader? Higher? Broader? Okay, so I'm gonna do this. Here we go. So a manager does what?
A manager organizes from behind the scenes and pushes them. A leader gets out in front and they follow him.
Or if we want to take that to the next step, which we must, because Ty was talking about that this morning, and he was talking about a leader is not over, but a leader is what? Under. So what's a leader doing then? If we're going to start thinking like a leader, what's this leader doing? Someone. It's a?
Serving.
So a leader is serving. What do you think about that? Try that on. Oh, you're going to run around with that?
I'll run around
with it. So a leader is what? Just so when you want to join in the discussion, just hold your hand up and we'll run around with the mic.
A leader grows potential.
A leader
grows someone's potential, their team's potential.
Oh, I like that. A leader grows someone's potential. Yeah. In fact, I want to pick up something Ty said this morning, and it was such a brilliant point. As he was talking, he said, look, the Pharisees, when they saw Peter, who did they see? Come on, Justin. Who did they see when they saw Peter?
An uneducated and unlearned man.
And who did Jesus see? Come on.
That's a sermon right there.
He saw what Peter could become.
Did you get that?
Yeah.
That's a leader's perspective. The Pharisees weren't leading. They were just managing their empire to make money. And they were very good at it. And Jesus comes through and he sees the genius in people. And out of that, he calls Peter and says, "Hey, Caleb, come follow me. And I'll take you to be a fisher of men." Others only saw that he swore and he fished and he smelt like yesterday's stale whatever. So what are you seeing? So here's an illustration for you, okay? I was in a meeting this last week doing a couple of NCD debriefs. In one of those meetings that I was in a church not too far from here, there was a lot of glare coming in. Now, what would a leader do? What would a leader be thinking at that point? What can we do to fix it? You know, there was only one person in the room who actually got up out of the chair, walked across and pulled the blind down. And yet, these were all leaders in the local church because they're all on the board. So they're all leaders, and yet only one person was doing what? Only one person was serving and stepping up and thinking, I can do something about that. Leadership. Leadership is service. Here we go, Justin.
Can you go to the first slide for us, Neil? I'm not on that one. I'm on our one. Whoop. No, yep, back. There you go. I think before we go anywhere else and we want to talk about spiritual leadership today, what is often misunderstood is what leadership is. And I love Ty's sermon because he kind of got to the crux of that. Often I meet people in churches who are victims. What do I mean when I say victims? Poor little me, we can't do that because this can't happen. Oh, it's because of that. It's all their fault. I hear can't. They'll often think because the conference has appointed a pastor there or the nominating committee's elected a group of elders, that pastor and those elders are the leaders of the church, which you could say that. Remind me, what is leadership? What's your definition? There's some stuff on the screen that might help. Leadership is servant. That's a style of leadership. Leadership is, it's on the screen, folks, help me, work with me, read it, it's influence. This is what is so misunderstood by so many people. We've got Dr. David Jamieson here speaking to us about what he's doing at a local church level. That local church is in a leadership role for the worldwide Seventh-day Adventist Church. He travels the world sharing what he's doing in his local church. He's not a conference president. He's not a division president. He doesn't work at the general conference. A local pastor is leading the world church in a particular area. We'll pick on some other ones. We could as well. There's lots of examples of this. I want to bring that back down to the local church for a minute. Can someone who is not the head elder, who is not the pastor, who doesn't even hold office, can they be a leader in the local church?
Absolutely.
How would they do that?
Influence.
you're reading the screen, man. God bless you. How would you influence?
Well, you actually know what's happening and people come up to you and ask you what's happening and the pastor gets his nose out of joint sometimes. Not where I am now, but, you know, it has happened.
So you upset your pastor? Is that how you do it, Stuart?
No, that's you don't upset the pastor. Answer, the pastor can get upset because people come to you.
Sure. Yeah. Well, that's an example that you're having influence. Tell me some positive ways, that's negative ways. some positive ways that a local member, they're not the pastor, they're not a head elder, they're not even a Sabbath school teacher, but they're going to have influences. Hands up here everywhere. Let's hear some answers.
So the lifestyle that person lives touches other people's lives so that they follow him.
Can I just take that first one? I want to pick on a name that many you'll know. His name was Joe Patrick. Bill, I know you know who Joe Patrick was. Joe Patrick's no longer with us. Joe Patrick was a member of the Warhope Church. Did anyone know Joe? Joe was the most Christian man you'll ever meet in your life. He used to go around the community giving out parcels and just being, he was an absolute sweetheart. Joe Patrick, when his funeral was conducted, I think there were between 700 or 800 people there. It was in his 80s. The undertaker said, "We never get this many people to come to a funeral, especially for someone that old. Sorry, folks, when you get real old, less people come to your funeral. You have to die young to have a big funeral." When Joe dies, 800 people turn up to a graveside funeral. Why? Because that man, through his lifestyle, through his Christian character, Ellen White calls it the best sermon ever preached, he was a person of influence, not only in his church, but in his community. There are other hands up there. How can you be a leader in your local church in a positive way when you don't hold a particular office? How else? Yes.
Showing people that you're interested in them and doing following Jesus' example, meeting their needs and just reaching them and winning their confidence.
Yes.
In you, that they know your heart of love towards them.
Loving people. Mm. And when I was a young fella, we'd go along to Sabbath school, often being at the pub on Friday night or somewhere bad or just didn't. We hadn't studied the Bible in a couple of years, let alone that week. And this old man, Dave Wilson, he was an old war veteran, took our Sabbath school class for the youth Sabbath school class every week. Poor Dave Wilson. We were shocking. I remember having a punch-up in the backyard at church with another guy. We both became pastors, the two in the punch-up. But Dave Wilson, every week at church, knew our name. He loved us. And he had to put up with a lot of stuff, but he was never fazed by it. And the way you treat someone at church just by the fact that you know their name means you're influencing the direction of the culture of that whole church. Just your action. That's leadership. How else? Pass that mic along. Yeah, go.
If you have a talent.
Using your talent.
Yes.
Absolutely. And it could be a vast array of talents and gifts that you use them. Absolutely. How else? Relationships and trust. And we heard that in the sermon today, how important trust is and being trustworthy. That's setting the influence of what a church is and where it goes. Yes. Down the back.
Valuing the contribution of the people that make one and enabling them to do more if they'd like to.
That's an excellent answer. There was a guy in the Bible that we just called Barnabas. It means son of encouragement. Barnabas's great contribution to God's work is he went and found Paul when no one wanted to use him. And Barnabas encouraged Paul. He later had a fight with Paul over a guy named John Mark, who wrote the Gospel of Mark, who Paul later had to acknowledge, but Paul wouldn't use him because he'd made mistakes. But Barnabas goes and finds the people that have made mistakes and he encourages them to get back involved. And giving some affirmation and encouragement can make a tremendous difference to someone's walk. There's some fantastic ways, whether you're the pastor or the head elder, that you can be a person of influence. Now, I want to just do one more definition and I'm going to kick it to you. You getting ready for this? Leadership is the ability to take people to a place where they would not go without a leader. It's so essential for someone, and Jack, you touched on it before, and I think we've got some stuff on our slides on the word vision. if a leader does not have vision, you don't have a leader. A leader is someone that has a picture in their mind of what needs to happen or where we need to go, and they take people with them. I just want to stress that. If you think of a train, it's at the station. What if that train leaves early and no one gets on the train? Was that train really useful? A leader doesn't leave the station until people are on board. And the role that vision has in leadership, I cannot stress that enough. Most people never make it in the world of leadership because of a lack of a clear vision. And at your local church, if you ever get to nominating committee and you ask people to do the jobs, and what do they all say? I cannot come to the banquet, don't trouble me now. We used to sing at camp, I've married a cow and brought me a wife. We changed the words around, we shouldn't have done that. I've married a wife and bought me a cow. I have fields and commitments that cost a pretty sum. Pray only excuse, I cannot come. If there's a lack of vision, there's always a lack of commitment. People want to belong to something that's bigger than themselves. And vision in leadership is so essential to its success. Now that's a bit of introduction. Does anyone want to ask any questions or make any comments on anything on that screen? We can't hear a word you're saying. The fans are too powerful.
A leader, if don't have tact and diplomacy, cannot be a leader, because you have to see what others cannot see, and also act on the right time and in the right diplomacy for the group. Because if you go ahead and the group will stay, that is no act of diplomacy.
That's so true, and tact and diplomacy means that your train leaves the station and no one's on it. So you have to have people on your train. When you go back to your local church, the one thing I want you to know, it doesn't matter whether you're the appointed a leader or not, if you have a vision, if you have a picture of what can happen, and that may be saying, this church is going to be the friendliest church in Australia, but hang on, I'm not on the board, I'm not on anything. What could I do the next Sabbath to see that vision come to fruition? I'd be the friendliest guy in the whole church, and then get someone else to share in your vision. So wouldn't it be awesome, we go home for lunch, wouldn't it be awesome if we could make this church the friendliest church in our town? And that other person says, what a great idea. So they come along the next week and they're there with you. And before you know it, you'll have a team. And before you know it, you'll have a friendly church. But you have to have the vision that we need to take this church. It's going to stay like it is forever if we don't do something. What are we going to do? You come up with a plan. I'm jumping ahead, Neil. But don't ever think just because you're not the conference president, or you're not the pastor, or you're not whoever, that I can't have an influence on the direction of a church. That's so disempowering. That's victim language. We are all victims in some sense by other people's behavior, but we choose to reject that and we say, I'm going to make a difference. That's the attitude of a leader.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can.
Interesting you said that, Justin, because when you both started this afternoon, you both labored the fact, we talked about head elders, pastors, and straight away you have then made two groups. We've got those who have got a name beside their name, when in actual fact, what we're talking about today are ordinary, everyday, run-of-the-mill people, regardless of their responsibility. And I think when we start talking like that, as you're just starting to do that now, that is where our key is, where we all take that responsibility, where we're all on the same level playing field. There's no one who has a title.
No. And I'm going to give it to you right now, Neil. Sorry, we're fighting over this. One last illustration. Have you heard of a book in the Bible or a guy named Nehemiah? What was his job? Let's think about the qualifications Nehemiah needs. What's Nehemiah's job? Before he built the wall, he was a cup bearer. What does a cup bearer do? One job in life. He has a jug or a bottle of wine, and whenever the king wants his cup filled up, he runs over, tops it up. And he should probably know a few good jokes. The king's looking miserable, he'll tell him a happy joke or smile a lot. Is he qualified to go and rebuild a city? Nehemiah was no one's victim. Nehemiah, didn't matter what status he had in life, he said, I am going to do something for God. If you have that attitude, God will use you. Amen. But if you're a victim, and I hear this, if I hear it once, I hear it 100 times. Oh, we can't. I can't. We would, but just don't let me hear that language. Nehemiah was a cup bearer. And he rebuilt a city in 52 days that had taken 100 years to not get the job done.
Can I say something?
Of course.
One thing I found with leadership, you can be a person of influence and not have a leadership position. If you have a leadership position and people look up to you in that position, whether you've got a title or not, you have a very responsible position before the Lord.
Awesome.
So it's an awesome responsibility, whether you've got a title or not.
Here we go. How many of you are leaders? Let's see a show of hands. All right. That's not quite everyone's hand. But it's all right. So we haven't convinced you yet that you're... How many of you influence others in your life? All right. See, we've still got a bit of a hang-up around this word leadership, yeah? What is leadership? Leadership, we said, right there... is influence. So if you're influencing someone else, guess what that makes you? A leader. And if you're a leader, then you're influencing others and you're changing things and you're making things better. It's actually even more than that. Another test of leadership is actually, is there anyone following? So there's this clip that appeared on YouTube a little while ago, and it was at a rock concert or whatever it was, some big event outdoors, and this guy got up and he just started dancing. Now, that's a very poor imitation, and I won't dance because I'll just sweat too much. But a guy got up and he was just all by himself, and it was a Harvard business study on this guy. And they said, now look at that guy. He's either a leader or he's an idiot. We don't know the answer to that question yet because he's all by himself. But we'll know the answer to that in a little moment. And the next thing came, and this is a really important point for you and your church. If your church has a vision, what you need next is what took place in this moment. So here's the guy, he's there and he's by himself and he's doing this thing. And then what happens next is another guy gets up and he becomes the first fast follower. What was he? The first fast follower. So now the guy, instead of being an idiot, is actually a leader because he's passed the first test of leadership. He's influenced someone else to join him. You with me? And now there's two of them. And now two looks a whole lot different to just one. And so now there's two there in the center, and someone else watches that and is influenced by that, and they become the next follower that joins him behind. And now pretty soon, there's a steady stream of people getting up. And guess what? Now leadership has influenced a good number of people that it's gone from that to now becoming a movement that's trending, and suddenly everyone gets up except for those who will never actually ever get up. So what's leadership? Leadership is influencing others to take them to a place where maybe they, did they want to be there, not them, not sure, but take them there anyway, and then they're happy to be there because, wow, suddenly whole new possibilities open up. Let's go on though. Matthew 16:24. My Bible's in my computer bag. I think it's at the back there, Andrew. Oh, it's under there. Justin, can you look that up for us? Got too many, not enough hands here. So Matthew 16:24, John 13:35, they're great verses. And what do these verses actually tell us? They tell us a great insight into how Jesus rolled. What we want you to start thinking of, if you're going to be thinking like a leader, one of the things that needs to be in your mind is, what can I do to add value now? How can I serve in this situation? And what's there should be in your notes. So if you're in those little notes there, you'll find them there somewhere. So what's it say, Justin?
Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me.
Okay, so it's a denial of self. And in actual fact, if you want to take that even further, Jesus said, if you want to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, what have you got to do? You've got to be willing to serve. There's been a lot of research done. There's a guy, Simon Sinek, who wrote a book called Leaders Eat Last. Fantastic book. And in that book, what he actually brings out is the science of leaders. And if a leader actually takes care of a team, which is what Justin has been doing in our conference office, he's been taking care of a team. And as he's been able to do that effectively, what happens is the team around him actually know that he's got their back. If I know Justin's got my back, that means I don't have to worry about infighting, which means where can I focus my energy? I can focus my energy on actually the job that needs to get done because I'm not having to worry about whether someone's going to stab me in the back. What happens is trust goes up. This is what Ty was talking about this morning. Trust goes up, and when trust goes up, productivity goes up because I don't have to worry about someone stabbing me in the back because he's got my back. The leader's got my back. I can focus now on actually getting the job done. And in your role of leader, whatever it is, as you influence, if you have the back of those around, if you serve everyone else, in that same book, what Simon Sinek brings out is that oftentimes the person who gravitates to the top of being like in the army, the commander of a unit, is not your most alpha male. It's actually the one who will actually go around and serve the unit. Will actually say, oh, mate, I notice you're not eating. How's your mum? Oh, I noticed that there's been, a couple of hiccups there. Are you okay? So that leader is actually becoming the camp mother of the group, and that makes the whole group perform so much better. What is that? That's servanthood. That's actually just serving your group, and when you do, it takes care of all their emotional input. Any thoughts or observations on that?
I just thought of a classic example of what you're saying, and that would have to be Desmond Doss. Quiet little private.
Totally.
And they wouldn't go into battle unless he came in the end.
That's it.
And they had to wait. They had to hold up the war effort while he had his devotions, because he wasn't going to go until he'd done that. And
he was an example of Jesus in the modern era that I think is nearly scriptural.
Yeah.
You could have a book on the Bible of Desmond Doss, because he demonstrated what Jesus was like, self-sacrificing love so amazingly that everyone was attracted to it. They couldn't resist it.
And even the ones who'd thrown their boots at him and done worse, in the end, when he lost his Bible, they risked their lives to find his Bible. So influence, incredible, absolutely. And I think I read once, leadership is influence, nothing more and nothing less. Thank you.
And if you're thinking like a leader, you can actually lead anywhere just simply by asking the right questions. Just think about it. I was in a seminar workshop recently, and at the end of a presentation by a colleague of mine, there was a moment where the question was asked, any questions? No one asked a question, and I was like gobsmacked. Like, how could you not want to know how this guy just did what he did? So then I asked a question. As soon as I asked the question, it led everyone into thinking about all the questions that they had, and suddenly the question session just opened up into a flood of questions. You can influence in any positive way just by the questions you ask. That's beginning to think like a leader. Go for it.
I have a question. Do you think our society, specifically as Australians, are just too timid when it comes to like interaction with people we see as like teaching and whatnot? Because like you've done that already a couple of times. Does anyone have any any thoughts or anything? And we've all been like, not saying anything, but really,
okay.
Is there like a social anxiety that comes with that?
There could be a whole bunch of reasons for that. Number one, our geography of this room is not ideal for conversation. It's actually just set up like a power moment, which is directed from the front down. So that doesn't now try this. How's that? Physically, how does that feel? It does, doesn't it? And I don't feel like as if I'm lording it over anyone. Suddenly, as Justin and I were talking yesterday, or actually Thursday, about doing our workshop here, we're like, oh, we don't want to do it up here. So why are we up there? Well, so people can see, but ideally, so geography plays a part, and yet much more than that. The ability to which we can create a place of safety, a place of trust. Yeah, how we doing? That if we can create that, then suddenly there might be no stupid questions. Because in the end, you might be thinking, oh, my question's a stupid question. And what's going to happen if I ask a stupid question? Others might laugh. They might think that's silly. They might not even answer the question. And so I'm just going to sit here, which is why when you ask a question, you're actually helping lead everyone else into thinking this is a safe place. You're becoming a leader. Go for it.
There's probably half a dozen other people thinking of asking the same question, but they don't want to stick their neck out.
Exactly, which is, and so you've become a rare person who actually steps up and does that. What I want you to notice that when you do that, no one dies. Did you notice that? You don't explode, you don't burst into 1,000 pieces, it's all okay because it's a safe place. You create that, you in your influence around others, you take them on that journey with you, you can do that. I'm going to hand over to Justin.
On your slides, as you flick forward, I want to have a look. In your book you've got on page 10, it's got the essential qualities of leadership. I want to talk about that. I have a book at home that's in my hand. It's not at home. It's called Spiritual Leadership. This is... I think it's up to about 1 million copies sold. At the time I got this, 750,000. This is possibly the best. There's so many books on leadership. We could talk all week and not cover a quarter of the stuff. This is the best book that I own on spiritual leadership. Neil's going to show a contrast on the leadership. I'll do this. I'll jump forward to the essential qualities, and you can come back and do that with the people. Is that all right?
Yeah.
If you have page 10 in your book, you've got a slide on this too, I think. Next one. There we go.
Yes.
He unpackages what real spiritual leadership is and what you need to possess this. By the way, I'm of the school of thought that we can all grow. Some people are just naturals. They're Don Bradmans. They pick up a cricket bat and they can hit a ball. That's true with leaders. Some people find it so easy, it's just the normal way they behave. For the rest of us, we have to learn and we have to grow. These are the essential things. If you want to increase your influence, not for your glory, but for the glory of God's kingdom and to further the work of the church, these are the things that you need. Number one on the list, what is it?
It's not nice.
Why would discipline, this is of you personally, your personal discipline, why would that be number one on a list of the essential characteristics of a leader?
Because the way you live your life is going to be imitated by the others.
Absolutely. They're going to imitate you. But hang on. Pass that microphone back. Okay, they'll imitate you. But why would they want to imitate discipline?
Wow. Because they see that it works for you and they're inspired by their leader.
Okay. That's a good answer. But I want to go a bit further and say, well, why does it work? What does discipline give you in life? Sorry? Gives you authority? Yep. Okay.
Oh, you got that?
Let me give you a practical example. If you stay up late to 1 and 2 in the morning, what is your devotional life like?
Takes a hit.
Simple answer. Crummy. Because you wake up tired. Leaders go to bed at a good hour because they know they have to start their day with Jesus, and this is so important to them that they get to bed as early as they can. Now, when you're a pastor and you've had a board meeting and you get home at 10:30, that's a bit tough because they beat me up tonight, dear. They didn't think what I had to say was a good idea, and you end up going to bed late and you wake up tired. And if you wake up tired, you will not have a good devotional life. If you want to be a good leader, you have to get out of bed early.
So, Justin, this is self-leadership.
You cannot conquer the world unless you can conquer yourself in Jesus.
Anyone feeling some pain around that?
Oh.
Because that's where the tough bit gets right there, isn't it?
I'm a night owl. That's why I'm picking on that example.
Well,
I know personally, if I go to bed late, my devotional life suffers.
Yeah, it's true. And we feel it.
There's some comments here, Neil, with that microphone. Yeah, you do.
And my wife notices it. Like, if I've gone to bed really late, she'll notice when I'm preaching, she calls it a happy sermon. In other words, I'm off with the fairies.
Can you... While you're off with the fairies, yep.
There's some comments here. Who's got the comment?
Jesus is our example, and he's discipled us, even though we're not the 12 disciples, but we are his disciples. And if we can disciple others after him, then that's the key of a true leader, is following the leader and allowing others to be influenced by the fact that we are following the leader and we're passing it down the line and it doesn't break. It's that chain of influence
fantastic. Follows
all the way down.
One thing. I think Jesus does disciple us through his spirit right now. Just as real, just as needed. He gets involved in the flotsam and jetsam of our lives and he'll slap us around as needed so that we can learn the lessons. The question is, am I listening? Am I learning?
Do a study, folks, on the people that have changed the world. John Wesley, Ellen White type people, George Whitfield. Guess what you'll discover? They all get out of bed early, very early, very early, because they've conquered half the day and it's 8 o'clock.
So the fruit of the Spirit, the very last one, is self-control, which is what you're talking about, which is discipline.
Discipline.
And I found the most powerful thing in my experience is praying with understanding. And when you're praying to be filled with the Holy Spirit, understand what you're asking for. You're asking to be filled with the fruit of the Spirit. And then
Amen.
Go through that list and you're challenged by every single one.
You don't need discipline. God, if you don't have discipline, God can give it to you, but you have to ask for it. Up the back here, we've got a hand from some stranger up there. Cole.
It's like anything in life. Discipline gives you effectual habits, good habits in life. You get good habits. So, athlete, you've got to be disciplined if you're an athlete, don't you? If you want to be a great swimmer, you've got to get up and you've got to do the laps. You've got to get up early and do the laps.
So correct.
It basically develops good habits in your life.
The flesh and the spirit are at war, and you have to be at war. And if you're not at war, you're not in the game. And John Wesley, his followers get called Methodists. Why are they called Methodists? Because they're methodical. They're methodical in the way they run their day. And their connection to God determined how their day was going to be run. That was the highest importance for them. And so if they are filled with the Spirit in the morning, then the rest of the day is going to be fine. Because they got it right. And that brings discipline. I've got to keep going on because we haven't got long. And there's a comment down the back. Question.
God hasn't given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound, disciplined mind.
Amen. Amen. We're going to go to the next one, which we've already spoken about, and that's vision. A vision is a compelling picture of the future. Simple thing. Wouldn't it be good if our Sabbath school class could increase by 2 members? Well, there's a vision. I just painted a picture. Wouldn't it be good if we could build a brand new church building that has enough Sabbath school rooms for the kids? That's a vision. Whatever little thing, big thing, a vision is what people, if you don't have something to aim for, you'll never hit anything. Vision is so essential for a leader. And some people are very good at it and some aren't. But it's something you have to learn and develop. There's a wonderful book. If you want to learn what a vision really is, there's a book called Full Steam Ahead. Full Steam Ahead, Unleashing the Power of Vision. It's the simplest reading book. It's a story. It's the best book you'll ever read on what the 3 components of a compelling vision. Full Steam Ahead, Unleashing the Power of Vision. Every pastor, theology student should have read that book. It's a very good book. We're speeding up. Wisdom. Where's wisdom come from? What is wisdom? Knowledge? No, knowledge is not wisdom. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. What's wisdom? Listening to your wife. I can't argue with that. He didn't say obeying. Did you hear that? He just said listening. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Wisdom is a gift from God. There are some very wise people in the Bible. Applying knowledge accurately, applying knowledge in a godly sense, it is a gift from God. It says in James 1 and verse 5, we can ask God for wisdom and he will give it without finding fault. James 1 and verse 5, that got me through college, that one verse. What's the next one on the screen? This is the easiest thing in the world for me. It takes me about a half a second to make a decision. My wife hates it. She hates it. And I don't know why that I'm just that way. I just make my mind up really quickly and I usually don't change it. That's a real fault at times. That's a real fault. I can't handle flippy, floppy, wishy-washy. That'll end with the adjectives. I can't handle that sort of leadership. No comment. People love when people are decisive, they make a decision. It can be the wrong decision, but please make one. Make the wrong decision, but make one. This flippy floppy, let's talk in the board meeting for 3 hours about the carpet. It's important if you're decisive that you can change your mind.
Yeah, go, Dave. Come on, you know you need to.
It is very important if you're a decisive person,
that's right,
you can change your mind. because you don't. I have.
Yeah, I know.
Two or three times.
Yeah, I got a record.
If you're not a decisive person, and she's a nurse, so she's had to go to work this afternoon, so I'm very safe. My wife is not decisive. We're the absolute opposites. And it's great. When she goes shopping, she looks all day and doesn't spend any money. It's fantastic. I love it. You make the decision, dear, because I know she won't make one. So I save a packet. But if I go shopping, I'm sorry, this is the male version, Justin's version of shopping. I walk in the shop to the thing I want. I can see the shirt. I like it. I buy it and go home. It was a 10-minute event. Boring, yes.
That's just called hunting.
It could be called a lot of things. I've got to move off decisive.
Just a minute before you do. Yeah. If you're decisive, you must be a good listener also.
Amen. I've got to, I agree. Courage. Unfortunately, leadership, as Moses described it in Numbers 11, he said to God, "Why have you laid this burden on me?" Oh boy, if you're really in a leadership position, every year that goes past in history, it gets harder and harder. And I just want to say, I'm embarrassed by the way our country treats our political leaders. Justin's included in our country. Because we love to bash our leaders, and they half the time really deserve it. But you don't want their job. You don't want to be the Prime Minister of Australia. What a job. And, Donald Trump, what a classic. This is just a train wreck. It's incredible to watch. But you know what I do love about Don? He's got a bit of ticker. If he says he'll do something, he does it. The whole world could end up in nuclear holocaust, but he's going to do it anyway. He's got courage. And unfortunately, when you stand for something, others will always oppose you. If you're getting opposed, you're usually on a pretty good path. Jesus said, "Woe unto you when all men speak well of you." Paul says in Galatians 1, if I was still serving men, I wouldn't be a servant of Christ. If I was still pleasing men, I wouldn't be a servant of Christ. Doing the right thing often means you have to stand on your own. That's where the discipline comes in, but it's mainly courage. If you care what people think about you, don't become a leader.
Does that mean by having courage you can be more decisive?
I think they go with each other. They definitely do.
It's courage in the Lord. If you're confident that God wants you to do a certain thing and He is your example and He's your leader, then you have that courage that's in Him. That's the difference
Amen.
Between Donald Trump and a Christ led.
Yeah, I don't want to pick on Donald. he may be doing a good job, but whatever. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. Down the front.
Just with courage, one thing that we never talk about is suffering. Jesus said, "Look at me, look what I've gone through." He did all the right things, but yet he still had all these people behind his back.
Amen.
And so he's saying that my followers, you're going to get it worse. And then we read
he did say that.
Paul in 2 Corinthians, all the things he went through, but yet he was willing to give his life. And today we need to have that attitude.
Amen.
To be able to give our lives to what we stand for.
Amen. These are very simple things, but the next one when it says humility, this is one of the most powerful books I own is a book by a Dutch reform pastor from, he was alive about the same time Ellen White was alive in South Africa, called Andrew Murray. Who has ever read any Andrew Murray books? His books on prayer, his books on anything, he wrote 240 books. He wrote a book just called Humility. It will cut you in half. Andrew Murray just basically says all sin is the opposite of humility. Humility is the opposite of sin. This humble, trusting person in God. Ellen White wrote in the book Desire of Ages, the only greatness, page 650, the only greatness is the greatness of humility. That's the only attribute in which you can impress God with. Not preaching, not even faith, all those things. God's not impressed. He's impressed with your humility. The only greatness is the greatness of humility. Do you want to keep doing some of these? You're going quiet on me. I'm worried.
No, it's all right. You're going to roll. You wrap it up.
Okay. Integrity. Why is that important? And people wouldn't trust you. If you didn't have integrity, you wouldn't be a leader. And integrity and sincerity are such an important thing to have other people follow you. They must trust you. And if you're not a trustworthy person, you can lose someone's trust and you can rebuild it, but it's very hard work. And you see this in a marriage when the marriage is unfaithful. It can be fixed, but boy, better off not damaging it. Better off keeping that trust and that integrity. I'll end it there for a minute.
You want to do the spirit?
I do. Let's do that bit. I think it's just back. There we go. Characteristics of a leader. And it just goes right into what our brother was saying before. Willingness to, what is it? To sacrifice and suffer. What have you given up to be a Christian? Just turn to a person alongside of you and just share at least just one thing that you have given up to be a Christian. I just want you to think about that. What have you given up to be a Christian? So in the beginning of family, you had to give up family. That's a sacrifice right there, isn't it? It's a big sacrifice. For some, it's a career or a big income or a sporting opportunity or whatever it is. There's things that we give up. Actually taking that to the next level though, in order to be leader. In order to be a leader of anything, in order to be a leader of Pathfinders, in order to be youth leader in the South Island of New Zealand when I was working there, there were things that I just thought, well, you know what? I don't want to even be bothered with that. Why? Because I just want to even avoid the appearance of giving someone the wrong idea. So for the whole time I was in New Zealand, I never went to a picture theater. And yet in our youth magazine, we had a movie review every month. So why? Well, I didn't want to encourage people to go, but I knew they were going, so I had someone do a review to get them into their thinking space. Did it matter? Well, it's only a movie. Who cares? There's something far more important that's at stake than whether I go to a movie or not, isn't there? And it's that. What are you willing to say? What are you willing to lay on the line? What are you willing to let go of? What's God calling you to let go of? So you can be a more effective leader. And this really gets to what David Jemison was speaking about this morning so beautifully in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. What? Whose kingdom come? Yeah, it's not your kingdom come. It's not so you can get the most toys and die and think you've won. It's actually so you can build his kingdom. So what are you willing to sacrifice to build his kingdom? I was in dialogue with one of our pastors this week. He's a volunteer pastor, taking care of a church. he puts $200, I think it's a month or a week, I'm not sure which, into the support of this little church, out of his own money. And I'm thinking, wow, what a godly example. You know, am I doing that? Am I willing to sacrifice that extent? I mean, I'll try and live as generously as I can. But I was challenged by that in a really good way.
I owed him one. I just have to say this. I'm talking to the pastors in the room. Everyone else, chill out. I got some pastors who, they don't go out at night because their kids are at home. They want to be with the kids. They don't work Sunday and they don't work Wednesday and they don't go out at night. And I'm so disgusted in them because they think that's going to help their kids. They're going to be home all the time. What are the kids going to see that their dad stands for? What are they going to see? What example is he giving their kids? I'm sorry, but as a pastor, I was out every night. I did try and spend time with my kids every day, pick them up from school, drop them at school, but I was out and I didn't have days off. I was busy. I took a Sunday off, so I'm with the kids. So you got to have a balance. But your kids need to see that you're willing to give up stuff for something that's important. And you're sending a message to them about what's important to you when you do sacrifice for God. And I think that's, I'm saddened that we've lost balance sometimes, that we think that the example we have to be is we all just sit around singing Kumbaya or something. That's not what we're about. We have an example from Jesus that we are going out to seek and to save that which was lost. That takes time. That means I'm not with my family when I'm doing that. And that's a sacrifice you have to make. If you're not willing to do that, you shouldn't be doing it. But I think God honors that. And you're showing your kids, you spend balanced time with them, but you're showing your kids that something matters to you. You're ultimately sending them a message. Sorry.
Love it. And the beautiful thing is this, that as pastor, you get to make it up in other ways. But there is sacrifice, and it's not just that. It's like for any one of us who becomes a leader in any area in our life, in local church or whatever it is, there are things that you have to be willing to sacrifice so you can lead. Like the number one complaint of our pastors about local church at the moment is no one is willing to take office. It's just tough getting people to commit to leadership. What's that tell us? It tells us there's a spiritual problem going on, and the spiritual problem is that people aren't willing to let go of stuff in their life so that they can serve. How are we doing with that? Now, of course, that everything becomes a juggling match, but in order to lead, we need a willingness to sacrifice, and then the other part of that is a willingness to suffer, because sometimes you're going to become a member of the tall giraffe society. Those who stick their neck out. You get what I mean? And if you stick your neck out, someone is likely to want to knock it off. Stick it out anyway. Actually be someone who gives a damn. Actually be someone who stands for something. Because if you're not standing for something, then you're just flaky. And we don't need flaky people, because flaky people are actually what you'd call politicians. They're just going wherever the wind of public opinion happens to go. I've worked with guys like that. Unbelievably frustrating. I gave them a term. I said they've got a revisionist view of history, which basically meant that, oh no, that's not what I meant at all. I meant something entirely different. Well, actually you didn't. I was there, I heard what you said, it was nothing like what you said. But they're just going with the squeaky wheel. We've got to actually have the courage of our convictions. Where do we get our convictions from? From His Word, from reading, from prayer, from study, from godly wisdom in our life. We get all that together, and now we come to the point where, as Justin said, you make a decision, you stick your neck out, and there's a willingness to actually go there. All right. We could look at Mark 10 and Philippians. We're going to go down to dependence, and I like this. In actual fact, I love what he does. Let's just look at this. Isaiah 42. just want to just read this, because all of these come straight out of this passage of Isaiah, which is just saying, hey, we want to model ourselves on Jesus. Let me read this to you. Behold my servant, whom I uphold, my elect one in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. So who's doing the election there? The Holy Spirit, or the Father is putting the Holy Spirit on the Son. He will bring forth justice to the Gentiles. He will not cry out, nor raise his voice, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break. A smoldering flax he will not quench. He will bring forth justice for truth. He will not fail nor be discouraged till he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands shall wait for his law. Beautiful. This is a picture of Messiah, and each one of these, like, where does he get his willingness to suffer and sacrifice? It's right there. He says, okay, I'm willing to be the suffering servant. Where does he get his dependence? His total dependence on his Father. His approval comes from God, who gives him the stamp of approval and says, yes, you're my son, you're my chosen one, I've called you into this. And then, it's formatting issues for the screen, but he's actually got incredible modesty. He's not going around big noting himself, which really gets back to what Justin shared before, humility. Just looking at, we could talk about empathy, which is ability to be able to not only listen, but listen with a heart to the what's going on in the life of those around you. Optimism in leadership is absolutely, wow. How many of you have been through a tough day or a tough week or a tough something in your life? Yeah? Yeah? Where we've all been baptized by fire. How important is it to have someone come to you in those moments and give you, hey, you can do this? I got to tell you, I felt like quitting when I was a Sabbath school youth teacher at Hillview Church as a kid growing up in the area. Just growing up, I walked out of Sabbath school class one day and I thought, oh, this is just useless. I should quit. Rob Puller that day came up to me and says, oh, Neil, I just want to affirm what you're doing and just say that, you know, I'm just so glad that you're doing what you're doing. And I'm like, man, how on earth did he know? How did he know that I just felt like quitting that day? I got a little, but actually it just felt really good. And it was incredible over the period of 12 months how every time I felt like I was being smashed, God sent someone into my life to be affirming and to build up, someone who had optimism for what they saw. Optimism is so important, isn't it? Just share with someone beside you, someone who's done that for you. Just take a moment just to say, someone has actually spoken into my life when I was discouraged and they gave me courage to go the next day. Just share your answer to that, just so you notice how important it is.
We need to talk about the difference between natural leadership and spiritual leadership.
We'll go back to that. Yeah. You have a break for a bit and I'll finish these characteristics. Of humour, anger, patience, friendship.
Oh, yeah, who does?
And then we'll go back to that other one.
All right.
Do you know where that is on the screen?
I'll find it.
Who's yours? It's not there. One, keep going.
Four.
Now keep the other way.
Yeah.
Next one after that. No. No, that's fine. I'll just do this out of the book.
Yeah, just take him there.
I think we've lost some time.
Oh, there it is.
Yeah, no, that's
it. All right. Just got to get it right.
Folks, I'm going to come back to the characteristics of leadership. I'll go a bit quicker here. There's so much stuff to cover. We've done a cry and cram it in for you. Any questions so far? Any clarifications that you need? I have to say that this list on the screen messed me up more than any I've ever read. More than any I've ever read. And I'll tell you which one that is. You might be able to guess. First one, the essential characteristics. This is according to, where's my book gone? J. Oswald Sanders, Spiritual Leadership. I'm just telling you to buy this book again. This is Sanders' list. He had humor. Why would he have humor as important for a leader? Sorry, Garrett. Stay grounded. Dave Price, have you got any comments here? David is the guy that cracks all the jokes at our ministers' meetings. Some of them are funny. When I was leaving college, in my fourth year, I tell the story often. Dr. Alan Lindsay was our history teacher at the time, and he was in the old E.G. White estate down the bottom when before it got moved. And I went and saw Dr. Lindsay when I was just about to graduate, and I said, what's some advice you'd give a young pastor? Really good advice he gave. Don't take yourself too seriously. That's such good advice. By the way, if you don't do it, someone else will. Don't take yourself too seriously. If you can't laugh at yourself, you're really probably taking yourself way too seriously, as if God's dependent on you. He's not. He's given you the privilege to get involved and be a part of it, but he'll do it without you, by the way, and without me. Good to know. This is the one that messed me up. An essential characteristic for a leader, anger. I'm a redhead.
More ways than one.
Neil knows I'm a redhead.
Shoot me now.
Oh, boy.
Just shoot me now.
I couldn't have coped with this one because that's something I've battled my whole life. It's a fruit of the flesh. Anger is listed in the fruits of the flesh, not in the fruits of the spirit. Why did this guy... this profound insight from this book, why did he list anger? He wrote it for me? Yeah, maybe. Jesus did get angry, didn't he? So all anger can't be bad. Most is.
Down the back.
Down the back.
I got an answer on that. I think that there's a room for righteous anger. You should get angry if somebody... hurt somebody else deliberately or something, that you should be angry about a serious injustice. You should be very angry.
Yeah. We can all get drunk on emotion. That's the problem with anger. You're able to get intoxicated with you and it starts to change your character to a bad place. But Jesus got angry and didn't sin. The Bible says be angry and sin not. Anger is usually an emotional response to injustice. And leaders get angry because they change things. If you're fired up over something, you'll do something about it. Leaders don't say, oh, that's terrible. What are we having for lunch? You know, they're disinterested. They have an emotional reaction because they're going to do something about it. And if the person's done wrong, they should fear that. Comment down the back.
Oh, yes, I agree with our brother here that Jesus had righteous indignation, for example, the widows and the orphans, but never for himself, never.
No, that's right, and that's where we have to be so careful, is because we're corrupted and anger can use us instead of God using us, and that's why it's listed in the fruits of the flesh. We have to be cool, calm, and collected. But injustice should move us to action.
Bill Hybels calls it his Popeye moment. Who remembers Popeye the Sailor Man? And Popeye gets to the point where he says, I just can't stand it no more. And then he cracks the spinach, he eats it, and he beats the baddies up. Now, that's the wrong use of power and all of that. But it's that moment where... he can't stand it anymore. He can't stand the injustice anymore. And it's that Popeye moment in leadership that's important.
Patience is often listed like endurance in the Bible. that here is the patience of the saints. That doesn't mean they just sit around, you slap them around the head and they go, oh, how are you? It means that they endure. They put up with things. They take the long view. I often say to young pastors, ministry is a marathon. It is not a sprint. And your work and life in the church, it's even truer. Ministry is not a sprint. It is a marathon. It's the long haul that's going to win. You got to just keep plugging away. Friendship. Why would friendship be important to a leader? Might need them. Yeah. It's lonely at the top. That's the truth. That's the truth.
I think because those it's really hard to influence people if you're at odds with them. It's a whole lot easier to influence your friends, isn't it? So if you cultivate friendships around you, it's got to be so much easier to lead.
When you lead people, you should always be friends with them. We were taught once upon a time that we were not allowed to be friends with our church members. We were taught that. Is that true, Des, that we were taught that? You couldn't be friends with your church members. We were taught that. Bray, were you taught that? You didn't listen, did you? He didn't do too well in that. I didn't like the idea when I heard it then, and I like it even less now. Because you're someone's friend, that shouldn't, if you truly care about them, that shouldn't make you biased. The reason the church had that stance, so when you have to do something in church, you might have to discipline. If they're your friend, you'll be biased. If they're your friend, you'll do the right thing before God. And being a friend, actually, I think the purest form of leadership is through a relationship. That's the purest form of leadership, is influencing others through a friendship or relationship with them. And that friendship can be a powerful thing for good. Tact and diplomacy, that's a bit obvious, isn't it? we've got a few stories about that, Neil. But you have to be very careful. When you're in a leadership position, you can say things that people will take the wrong way. You learn quickly to be very careful with what you say. True statement, Neil?
Oh, absolutely.
Very true statement. Let me go quickly. What's the time?
4:00.
Well, we've only got half hour. I was going to give you a break, but we're not going to now. We're just going to finish. That's tact and diplomacy. How is a leader inspirational? Give me some ways that you've seen a leader be inspirational. Lead by example. Lead by example. What else? Really excited. Passion. Passion, such a big thing. It inspires people to see that passion. Sorry to get into politics for a minute. And this is wrong. I shouldn't do it. But I'm not going to be the president after tomorrow, so it doesn't matter. Okay? But the other day, our prime minister ripped into the opposition leader. What did he call him? A sycophant. I had to look it up. I Googled it. Oh, you said that, not me. I'm still the president. He called the opposition leader and he was fired up in a way. His own party had never seen him fired up like this. All of a sudden, the opinion polls are all gone up on this guy because he stands for something. He doesn't like Bill Shorten, you know. He stands for something. He let it rip into him. And everyone is all so upset because that's not how you should behave in the parliament. They had been goading him for weeks, calling him Harbourside Mansion. And he'd done nothing. And they were getting under his skin. and he just launched this missile. And they've never called him it again. Have you noticed? They've stopped. Oh, that blew up in our face. He was passionate. Passion is a great inspiration to others when you see someone that actually stands for something. What else? How have you seen someone be inspirational? Preachers are often inspirational, aren't they? And the sermons we've been hearing this weekend, great example that if you're a church member and you come along, you hear inspirational messages, you feel inspired to go out there and be a better Christian. Over here.
Yes, I don't mind saying when Pastor Peter Watts came to our church, he inspired our whole church to Amen. Get up, go out, and we have got contacts from him being inspiring us because he was inspired himself, and I'm not surprised he's going to work for the conference.
Amen.
God bless him.
He's a very good man, Peter. I called him into this conference.
One way I find people be inspirational is when they share stories from the past where things have worked really well, in that where like they want to do something and they share how it's worked in the past, and you're like, yeah, we can do that as well.
I'm going to tell you a story, and I'll go to Jonathan then. I'm going to tell you a story. I was a pastor in Los Angeles. There was one family. Every time we had a meeting on, mum and dad and the three kids were at the meeting. Didn't matter which day or which time of the day, if it was outside of the work hours, they drove a long way to come to that meeting and support it. Didn't hold that. I think dad was a deacon. I went to their home and I'm nearly emotional. I nearly want to cry as I tell this story. I'm going to hold it together. I went to visit the family. I'll never forget it because they lived in someone else's house. The whole family lived in one bedroom. The kids slept on the floor, mum and dad in the bed. The five of them in this one bedroom. You'd never know that. And I know every lunchtime when he stopped for lunch at work, he always had his Bible and he read his Bible, not only in the morning and the evening, he read it for 15 minutes every lunchtime. And they didn't want to be the leader of the church or anything like that. They just wanted to support God's work. And that family lived in one bedroom. And it so made me ashamed, and I am so inspired by that family to this day. They don't know it. When I saw that, it messed me up. It makes me emotional now. They are such better Christians than I could ever dream of being. And when I see that, that inspires me. I've got no problems. You got any problems? I got nothing. Let's get back to the notes.
A little thing to note, when you talk about inspiration, I think of
two people in the world that come to mind quite quickly. Martin Luther King. When he did that speech, I Have a Dream. And you know, that has resonated around the world how many times? And people still talk about that today, and he's long gone. And I think about him having a dream of freedom, and I think we all have that. We have that dream of freedom, and yet we have another man in Hitler who was unbelievably inspirational, but for the wrong reasons. Yeah.
And that didn't end well.
That brings us right back to that one right there.
Okay.
The difference between a natural leader and a spiritual leader. Someone who's doing it in the flesh, someone who's doing it in the spirit. That's in your notes. It's whatever page it is in your notes. Ellen White says, you know, without daily communion with God, no human can gain power for service. Someone who's spiritual leading, they're confident in God, they're communing with God, they're spending time in the Word, they know God, they seek God's will, they're humble, they follow His example, all of that. It sets them apart and actually gives them authority to speak. Gives them authority to speak. We're going to change gears from that though. I got a question for you. How many of you are leading in the local church setting in one form or another? Just a show of hands. Okay, now just keep your hand up. Keep your hand up now. If you've got a goal that's set for what area you're leading in. Do you have a goal? If you do, just keep your hand up. If you don't have a goal, just drop your hand down. Okay, so there's some of you now who have got goals. Fantastic, because what we want to talk about here, there's a lot of research that just says something as simple as this. If you get a dream board, you know what a dream board is? Where you just get a blank piece of canvas, and on that canvas, you just put all the dreams that you have for different areas of your life. It might be dreams for your spiritual life, dreams with your family, dreams with church, dreams with the areas that you're leading, whatever it is, and you just put your goals down on that and you hang it on the wall, and it just reminds you. The mere fact that you take time to put your dreams down like that, guess what happens? Your chance of success goes up enormously. Setting goals is important. Justin, just step us through real quick some of the goals we have as a conference.
One of the goals was we would have 1,000 people come to Leadership Weekend. I just got told before that we've actually, it wasn't 996, we've already cracked over 1,000. We set by 2019 that we'd get 1,000 people come to this weekend. We've already met that now in 2017, 2 years ahead of time. So we need to reset that goal, but that was part of our strategic plan. That's exciting, and because we had that goal, that made us act in a certain way to achieve it. This is the beauty of a goal. If you do not set goals, you will underachieve every day of the week. And I learned this when I was pastor at Port Macquarie. Bill and Gary and others that here were members there at the time. I set that every year I'd get 20 baptisms. And in 4 years, we got 84 baptisms. And if I hadn't have set that goal, you can't get focused.
If you didn't set a goal, you would have got it.
Well, yeah, you got nothing.
You would have got exactly right. What you aimed for, which was nothing.
Nothing, yeah, that's
and
true.
When I was...
Did you see him skip over here then?
I did. Now, here's the thing. When I was in Victoria, we spent about 6 months working on our vision for the year, well, for the next couple of years of ministry. And guess what? When I left Victoria, I looked back, and I look at that and I think, wow, about 90% of all of those outrageous goals we set, we knocked off. Because like Justin said, we actually had a plan. Well, here's what our conference ones are.
We've exceeded the 55% of tithe. We're over that already. And hoping it'll continue to keep... We want the office to get smaller and the field to increase. I think that's what needs to happen. That's where it all goes on. That's already happened. The 30 churches, we're not there yet, but we're really on our way there. We're getting very close.
So last year, yeah, that's right. Last year we were looking for 7% of baptism. Well, last year of our attendance. So if you've got 100 people at church, it means we would want your church to get 7 baptisms. Last year we had 270 around their baptisms. If we're going to hit 7%, that number's going to jump to 450 odd. That's quite a jump, isn't it? That's a goal that gets the juices sort of, ooh, how can we get to there?
This year, where were we? We're not sure yet.
It's around 270.
Yeah. Still broke the records for what we had, but we're not proud of the records. We need 500 baptisms a year, I think, in this conference to truly get back to what our pioneers wanted it to be.
Now, Obed... One of our pastors, and I'm not sure who else, but there's a bunch of them, they're going to Kenya for a mission campaign. Guess what the goal of that conference is, or that part of that union is? They want 1,000 baptisms by the end of a month? No, that's not big enough. 10,000, still not big enough. 100,000, still not even close to being big enough. You could multiply that by 10, and now finally there's a goal they're aiming for. They're aiming for 1,000,000 baptisms. Now, just think about that. That's a staggering number, but that's a goal that should terrify you and at the same time inspire you, because here's the thing. It's the same God in Australia that's leading the church here as the God in Africa that's leading the church there. And the same God leading the church in Fiji, where one guy plants 12 churches, the largest of which is 300 members. And I just got a little excited about that. And I'm just thinking, wow, you know, God's given us the commission. It's not the great suggestion, it's the great commission.
Can I talk about that goal and how it impacts our decisions?
Go for it.
So we set the goal of 7% and we look around, it was 2%. That's real. We get 2% at baptisms. That's across the country. That's not good enough. So we've put on again a full-time evangelist in Peter Watts. Is that enough? No, we need two more. I believe we need three full-time evangelists in our conference as well as our churches functioning healthy and strong if we're going to meet that goal. So setting a goal, you'll realize, oh, we're not going to make it. We have to do something different here.
Imagine, you have to do something different.
Where if you don't set goals, and apply this to your local church just your personal life. If you don't set goals, I set a personal goal this year that I'd be out of debt. That's going to happen on the 28th of February. I'll be debt-free by the grace of God. I sold my house, you know. The market's high. There's no other way I could do it. And I'm able to own another house outright because of that. I was broke at age 40. I'm 47 because we went through the GFC in America. God has blessed us amazingly. But if I don't write down and set a specific goal, I will not act accordingly to achieve it.
In fact,
you have these churches just floating along in the stratosphere, Neil. I don't know what they're trying to do.
Well, without a goal, what we're actually planning for is status quo. And who's happy with beige? Who's happy with status quo? Just a show of hands, all of those who are happy with the color beige. Who's happy with more of the same? Who's just happy with just going along on what we've got?
What's wrong with beige?
Well, beige is just blah. It's not a color at all. It's just blah. So what if we actually started setting goals that actually terrified us a little bit? What if we actually had some goals for our Sabbath school department? What if we actually, instead of just communicating with ourselves with our conference magazine, what if we had a goal that we're going to communicate with the world with our conference magazine? You with me? Because we're doing it anyway, so why don't we just take that and set a goal that actually demands that God turn up and do something with us?
You've got to personally and corporately in your local church set goals every year. And if you don't make a goal, we'll have a discussion and say, well, why didn't we? What do we need to change? What do we need to do differently in order to achieve that? You'll just do so much more for God's kingdom when you set goals personally and corporately as a church.
So here we go. If you're going to set goals, What you actually need to do is not have too many. Nehemiah came in and he had to assess the landscape. And when he assessed the landscape, what did he decide? He just decided that what we needed to do was just start with doing one thing. What was it? Build the walls. Let's just get the walls done, people. Let's get the walls done. All he could see was walls that were broken, that were fallen down. And what I love about what he mobilized around that vision, it was a very simple vision, a very big vision, because they'd been there for a long time and nothing had really happened. And he turns up and he sells them on the vision. He says, this is what we're going to do. We're going to Fiji. We're going to get there. We're going to baptize 20 people in our church this year. We've never done it before. We're having a goal. We're going to raise our NCD score by 10 points this year, which will translate into a much warmer disciple-making church. We're going to set ourselves a goal to run a couple of missions. We're going to set ourselves a goal of actually launching a men's ministry that services solo mums' cars. And we're going to really rock this town and set the world on fire. We're going to have a goal that makes a difference. So they get that goal going, and he had that. And then he actually, now for you, how do you do that in your local church? Well, you can have a retreat, you can get together and you can pray, you can talk with your leadership group, you can talk with friends, and you can actually start to shape up what that is. And whatever that goal is, just ask this question of yourself, thinking like a leader. Does this scare me a little bit? If God doesn't turn up, can we still do it? It's a good question to ask yourself, because most of, you know, we heard David Jemison mention this, that if God didn't turn up, mostly what we do would still keep happening. So where's God in that? Well, let's increase the faith. Let's have a faith of a Nehemiah. Let's have the faith that even though opposition comes in, you keep one hand on the brickwork and one hand on the sword so you can keep laying the bricks. Do you want to jump in?
I just love setting goals, and I just want to encourage everyone here in your local church. I'm going back to a local church. I'm moving out of my house on Monday, Tuesday, moving towns, getting to that local church. There's 400 and something members there, and we've got another congregation with 50. I've been talking with the associate pastor, and we've determined between us that we'll get 50 people in Bible studies this year. There's 5 currently. And they're all kids in the church. Hmm. How is that going to be possible? Is that too high, 50?
How big's the church?
400 members.
Oh, that's too low.
Tough town. I tell you, 50's going to be hard.
Yeah.
But I want to tell you that in the mornings, what do you think I'm praying about? I'm not just saying, Lord, please look after my kids. And that's important. I do that every day. Please look after my wife and, I don't know, Neil. Help Neil.
Need a lot of help.
I'm saying, Lord, for your name and for the sake of your church, give me 50 souls. And I found a couple here this weekend. If you know anyone in Canberra that's an ex-Adventist or any connection to you that I can go and visit, I want their names.
Now, you've got Anna on your radar, haven't you?
I've got a whole lot of people already. And I want to tell you, giving myself a goal gets me focused. So in the week time, I'll have to do board and business meetings. I visit the church members. That's all. I love visiting the church members. But the thing that will really fire me up is finding 50 people to get them in Bible studies. And in fact, if you start a prophecy seminar, you can easily get 15, 20 people in 1 hour studied with. 50 is not so high then. You can do this. This is doable. But if I didn't have a goal, I couldn't be focus and it wouldn't drive me and affect my prayer life and everything I do. You have to pray these things or God will never bring it to pass. Our time must be nearly up.
It is just about, but I'm just going to speak to the pastors and the Bible workers here just for a moment. What if you guys, so here's a vision. What if you guys were the rain maker for your church? Now by that I mean that you took a very special role, and our senior elders could do the same, or our elders team could do the same. What if the rainmaker, all the rainmaker's job was to go looking for the next Bible study, and then you hook up your members with another study, and then you go around and you keep looking for more and more, and you get those, and then you go around and you inspire and you train and you coach the members so that they know how to do that, and so you breed success with their success. And you become the rainmaker. And I think this is one of the things that stood out of your leadership in Port Macquarie, that you built a team of people who could actually do that. It's what we did when many different places where I've worked, we build a team of people in youth ministry to actually champion and take it on. The greatest times then are when I sit back and just watch the team go. Don't have to do anything. It's leadership then is really easy, because you just release your team. Goals are just so important. Set a big goal. We call it, our pastors all have a monthly minister's report to do, and all of them have to set goals for the year, and all they're reporting on are 3 what we call big, hairy, audacious goals. A BHAG. And their BHAG should scare them a little bit. It should cause them to get on their knees and pray a lot. They should be set in consultation with their local church leadership. If we want our pastors to do that, I want you to do that. I want you to have a goal. You could have a goal for growing your spiritual life. Remember, Justin spoke before about the importance of discipline. If you don't become self-disciplined and learn to get leadership of yourself going, boy, that's a big topic. We'll talk more about it at Big Camp. But if you don't get mastery of that, what you're actually planning is just more status quo. And status quo is killing us and hurting us. Weekends like this are about stepping up as leader, stepping up and knowing that with Christ, I can just do a couple of things. Isn't that right? With Christ, I can do how many things?
All things.
Nah, just a couple of things. Really, isn't it? You're sure it's all? Well, there's a couple saying amen. What about the rest of us? Can we do all things through Christ that gives us strength? Is it really that easy that if I tap into the power of Christ, I can do all things? I can handle suffering. I can handle heartache. I can handle deprivation. I can handle criticism of people around me. I can handle all of that and so much more. Leadership, if I want to leave this final thought with you, you know, as Justin and I, we've had many conversations over the years, and we look at who are the people we employ on our team, because we get lots of people saying, yeah, we want to come and work in your conference. And we're like, yeah, we'd love you to work in our conference. Guess who we pick? We go back to Acts chapter 6. And in Acts chapter 6, there's a story that unfolds, and in that story, the disciples had a problem, and that is they needed another layer of structure in their church. They needed someone who could step up and be servants. And who did they pick? Help me out. They were men or women of what? They were faith and?
The Holy Spirit.
Full of what? Full of the Holy Spirit. They're already anointed by God for leadership. That's who we look for. Leadership in the end is influence, and in our business, that influence is spiritual. And the only way you get that is how? By connecting to the source, which is Christ. There's no shortcut. There's no, oh, look, give me a 5-minute rule for that. It's actually time spent on your floor, time spent in the Word. One of the things I'm really enjoying at the moment, and it's a sign of the times, Justin, I had to buy a new Bible that had print in it that was big enough for me to read without glasses and verse numbers that I could see. And over the holidays, I've been loving making it my own all over again. There's no other way to get influence of the kind we're talking about comes through this and through prayer. And then you set goals and you go hard and you work as hard as you can. And when you've done all that's in your power to do, you leave the rest up to God.
Thanks, Neil. We want to thank you for coming this afternoon. I just want to give a plug. A lot of people don't know what this Shark Tank thing is. I saw them rehearsing it, what they're going to do at the office the other day. It is hilarious that they get into it. Don't miss that tonight. Russell was on fire. And Russell Halliday, he's very good. Folks, just wherever you go, please never be a victim. You might have had some bad stuff happen to you. I go and visit ex-Adventists. There's one thing you'll find in common. They're victims of someone else said something or didn't say something or did. I'm sorry, I'm never going to be anyone's victim. I got lots of reasons I could bring out and say I've been a victim. I'm not going to do that. My little influence I'm going to use to make a difference for the glory of God. And if we all take that attitude, you've got influence in whatever sphere it is. Commit to that. Don't waste it. We only get one crack at this. Use your influence for the glory of God. Let's bow our heads together. Father, we thank you that we can be people of influence. We all acknowledge this afternoon that we're unworthy of it. how could you ever use us? But you do again and again, and I thank you for that. May we not waste this opportunity, Lord, but use it to further your kingdom, to brighten our churches, to uplift those that are struggling, to bring new people to Jesus, whatever it is. We pray that our influence would be for your glory and your good. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, everyone.